Good morning, wherever you are in the world. I am Patrick D. McCoy, and welcome to Across the Arts for this exciting installment of the Opera Diva series. I hope that you will enjoy our very special guest to this series. Soprano Roberta Alexander appeared as Pamina at the Houston Grand Opera in 1980, as Daphne in Santa Fe in 1981, and as Elettra in Idomeneo in Zurich in 1982. Following a tour of Europe, she made a successful debut at the Metropolitan Opera in New York as Zerlina in November 1983. Among the operatic heroines, she is unforgettably, portrayed are the title role in Janacek's Jenufa in a Glyndebourne production, Mimì and Puccini's La Bohème, and especially the great Mozart heroines. Fiordigeli and Così fa tutti, Donna Elvira and Don Giovanni, and among many others. Ms. Alexander is a native, well, was born in Lynchburg, Virginia. We're gonna make all kinds of ties this morning. But without further ado, please welcome the legendary soprano, Roberta Alexander. Good morning.
Good morning. Hello.
If you don't mind, my trainer is gonna dictate that I call you Miss Roberta. Is that okay?
That's fine.
Thank you. Now, I kind of led off about Virginia because I want people who may not know your Wikipedia bio or your formal bio, so I want to give them a glimpse into your whole kind of background. So let's start off. Well, first of all, I know we kind of talked offline about the pandemic, but the reason I kind of want to talk about the pandemic in so many respects is I was so ecstatic to see you in the whole virtual panel situation. And I remember when Laquita Mitchell, when she interviewed you and Colleton Freeman and Janet Williams, and I'm missing somebody. Howard Haskin.
Howard, yes. Oh.
And his sister's birthday is today, Tamara. But anyway.
Hi, Tamara. Happy birthday.
And I was so happy to see you in the firmament of that. So just very quickly, we don't have to talk a lot. What was it like for you getting into the technology because of the pandemic?
You could only call it being dragged into the 21st century, kicking and screaming. Because I knew, I mean, my whole experience with the whole computer thing is turn it on and off, and it has to do it. And so, you know, all this stuff about the microphone and where the camera is. I mean, I didn't even realize that there was a camera. So it was, and whether you do Zoom or you do some other format and how you do. So anyway, I was extremely grateful in the end for having younger people teaching me the ropes, so to speak. I'm still only good with just this one type of thing, mind you. So it was quite daunting, I must say.
Yeah, I'm sure, because everybody's learning. Like, as you can see, I was still learning how to connect this and do this and send the interview this place. So you are not alone, trust me. So I want to go back, you know, because I talked about your Virginia roots and you being born in Lynchburg. Could you maybe take the audience maybe from Lynchburg, or how was your musical upbringing kind of structured there?
Well, I don't really remember much about Lynchburg because even though I was born there, that has a whole different backstory. I'll get to that in a moment. My parents moved to Ohio when I was 2 years old. My parents met at Virginia State University in 1946. I guess it was right after the war, because my dad was back in the choir, and my mom had been had gone there in the choir, and they met there, and they got married in 1947, and they moved to Lynchburg because my dad had the choir at the high school in Lynchburg. He was a choral conducting student of Harold Montague, and their theory teacher, both my parents' theory teacher was Undine Moore, who I called Aunt Undine. You know, what did I know? But unfortunately, I never got to, I think I must have met Montague, but I was only like 1 year old when he died. Anyway, so my dad, they moved to Lynchburg, and he was the choral, he had the choir at the high school. He also coached tennis. And jack of all trades. And then I was born in 1949. Some friends of theirs who also were graduates of Virginia State moved to Ohio because the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base was hiring people at very good salaries to learn how to be programmers. So my parents moved to Ohio because that's where my dad could make a living doing that. And obviously in Lynchburg, that wasn't really gonna happen for them. And they moved to Wilberforce, and so did I, because my dad got the choir at Wilberforce University, and my mom taught voice at Wilberforce University. So we moved to Wilberforce, and that's basically where I grew up, was in that area. That's my first memories. I still have vague memories of the backyard in Xenia, Ohio. But Wilberforce is where I really, started to understand what this was all about. And there were always concerts, and my mom was always concertizing. She was singing with the Dayton Philharmonic, and also she played for the choir because she was a wonderful pianist, as well as being a, drop dead soprano. And so I never knew any other kind of thing other than classical music. I was only allowed to go to my mom's concerts if I didn't sing along, because I knew all of her arias. And I thought this was absolutely fantastic. Because Wilberforce, Black university that is funded by the AME church, one of the things that the chorus had to do was sing for two services on Sunday morning. So my parents never left me, by myself. So I went to these church services and sat in the choir. I turned pages for my mom. I also eventually sang whatever voice was needed up to a point in the choir, in their offering on that Sunday. And I had piano lessons and flute lessons and dance lessons and all kinds of things. No voice lessons until I was until I went to Virginia State out of high school. Anyway, so it just is in the blood,
Now, if I'm not mistaken, wasn't there like a special summer institute that you attended? Could you talk a little bit about that at Virginia State?
Willis Patterson, Dr. Patterson, had a like a summer school for young Black kids of like, I would say maybe high school age. When I went, it was 1964 because I was still, I was a junior in high school then. Yes, that's correct. And there were lots and lots of, like, I would say maybe 40, 50 kids.
Wow.
Who went to this, and we had a choir. We did South Pacific, voice lessons, all kinds of things. But we were absolutely all on the same wavelength of the classical music, and he made this happen. And I it was a wonderful experience. I met Raymond Bazemore, was one of the people that I met in that summer, and we actually ended up, I think, being freshmen together in our first year of university, which my first year of university at Virginia State, which was then in 1965. Unfortunately, it was not a very successful year of schooling because I acted out, just to put it mildly. Yeah, well, I was 16, a freshman in college, and I had never been away from home, and I had a great time.
I'm glad to know that all of us are in good company in this whole idea of acting out, because I think we all act out at some point. So.
Oh yeah, this was so. Basically, my parents just yanked me out of there and threw me into Central State, which was across the street from our house.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, which also turned out okay. But but Virginia State, you know, it's just, my grandmother lived in Petersburg, but it was a very strange time. They were so strict. The women, or as they call them, girls, the curfew was 8 o'clock. You had to be in the dorm at 8 o'clock on weekdays. You could not wear trousers except on Saturday morning. I even had to have a written letter to go visit my grandmother because that was off campus. I mean, they just sat on you. No, it was just, you can't even imagine it now.
About to say that, but on the flip side, it's like that kind of discipline, that kind of expectation of class and how one carries themselves. To me, like, I know maybe not to that degree, but a lot of that to me now is definitely lacking. So I wish that we could go back to some of those things. But I just want to note further about how you were just immersed in, you know, all of this musical excellence from your parents, your mother being this soprano and your father being a conductor. But I want to fast forward to something that you mentioned on your Facebook page, if you don't mind, because I was so enthralled and so enamored with it. You talked about an occasion that you sang for this big event, because I hopefully I want to draw it out of you. You sang for this big event for this famous soprano, and your choice of aria you was kind of thinking about. Could you maybe talk about that for the audience?
Well, yes, I am. This will go under the heading of things you do when you don't know any better. Leontine Price was also an alumni of Central State University. And in 1967, they awarded her an honorary doctorate. And on this, they called it a convocation at that time, but this occasion, since I was in the voice department, we were all a flutter, you can just imagine.
Because we all had the Blue album. So I was asked to be one of the persons who sang a selection on this occasion. And I picked Return of Etchitor. With my 18-year-old self.
I had no concept of what I was doing, obviously. She was very gracious. She did not say, girl, go sit down. Very gracious. And what I remember most about that entire time was that we, as students, we couldn't afford tickets to her concert in Dayton, at her recital in Dayton. And what Memorial Hall did was they let us students be ushers for that concert so that we could get in. And it was marvelous. It was just, I wept. Just the sheer beauty. And I don't know. I mean, it was one of those things where you just thought either you're never going to open your mouth and try and sing again, or you're going to say, okay, I'm going to aspire to that. Just look at what she's doing. Amazing, amazing. But honestly, it remains one of the high points of my whole life, actually, was that moment.
Wow, I couldn't even imagine. So kind of take me from that kind of plateau. You're at Central State, this convocation, you're singing for Leontine Price. And so now you've finished your undergraduate study. Right. How did you know your path, like, because some people, for instance, you know, I know people who they studied music, but they do other stuff in the middle. Kind of got me to your path where you knew I want to be on the great stages of the world in opera.
I never wanted to do anything else. That from the time I was about 7 or 8 years old, that's what I wanted to do. Now, whether that would actually happen, that was something completely different, but that's basically, I loved the whole thing, not just the singing, but I also was fortunate enough to do some straight theater also as an undergrad, and it never occurred to me to want to do anything else, and my parents did not discourage that. So I was very, very lucky to have gotten, I must say, I think personally, to have gotten off of the Puccini-Verdi pathway. And at that time, being very young, you know, 18, 19, 20, 21, onto the Mozart pathway. I think that might have saved me. I mean, not that I didn't want the other, but it was just at a certain point, it was very obvious that that wasn't my voice type. No matter how much I wanted it to be my voice type, it wasn't, that's not what I was. So That took a lot of getting used to, I must say, because I wanted to sing Trovatore and Turandot and I don't know, Isolde, all kinds of stuff. Everything that was not appropriate.
So since you just mentioned Mozart, I do want to treat the listeners to a little excerpt, because it's just so ironic that you mentioned, like, the key, of course, that's a lot of your body of work, as I mentioned in your introduction, has definitely been the glorious roles of Mozart. So I do want to play a little excerpt. If you would bear with me with this technology, hopefully we can do that. And I won't play the whole thing because
they're so long.
Yeah. Oh, yes. And as I mentioned, like, sometimes YouTube will pull your stuff down. So let me just make sure. Let's see. What can I do here? Got a lot of stuff going on, so just bear with me. This is a lovely recording that I found of you singing Mozart, Aspiegate o Dio. I'll just play a little bit of this. I think it's so beautiful. And then we can maybe talk. I know a lot of singers don't like to hear themselves, but you are gorgeously gifted in this repertoire. So I do want to play a little bit. So we were talking about, kind of led off talking about your Mozart roles. Of course, that was one of your Mozart songs. But the reason I wanted to kind of enter the song repertoire, because you said something earlier, like, you also studied theater. And I'm sure that in addition to theater, you know, at some point you have to study the language and understand the language and what you're singing about. So could you maybe talk about your process in terms of, how does one prepare for a recording versus, you know, live performance? Because I know that that was from the Et Cetera label. You did a lot of recording. And so I'm sure there's a transition that one has to make. Could you maybe talk a little bit about that?
Well, the biggest difference between the two is
when you're on stage, you don't get any do-overs. So if you make an error or something doesn't go the way you want it to, you have to learn how to let that go in a live performance, because you're never going to get that back. Those, they're gone forever. They're out in the ether, and that's it. When you're doing a recording, if you have enough time, you can say, okay, I'd like to do that phrase again, because that didn't come out the way I like it. And then you can concentrate on what you did wrong. The preparation is the same. Mm-hmm. First of all, you never know who's going to be listening to you. You could be somewhere in the middle, in the depths, down in the depths of Holland, somewhere, you know, it's not even hardly on the map, and you think you're safe. Somebody has got a recording device, and before you can turn around, it's up on YouTube. So it doesn't matter. I mean, this is, of course, a recent phenomenon, but it really did. It happened back in the day, you know. People would, you'd have pirated recordings of things. We I was in the audience, and it would be some obscure place where you thought, well, I'm going to try out something, you know, I don't know, like Nuit d'été or Scheherazade, you're going to try it out somewhere, you know, not to, and then all of a sudden, there it is, you know, and it's like, oh my goodness, this is for everyone to hear. So you learn really early on that whenever you open your mouth, wherever it is, you better be ready.
Mm-hmm.
And with all of what it entails to be ready, because it really doesn't matter. Is it? It's all about your your own standard of excellence.
Mm.
Did I sort of wander off too far?
No. You hit it right spot on. I mean, especially that standard of excellence. And I want to kind of go back to something I kind of lifted up in the beginning. You know, I was talking about the virtual presentations, and something that I really enjoyed immensely was when soprano Laquita Mitchell had you all on the panel, and you were talking about your journey in Europe, because I think that's very important to discuss, because a lot of times, I mean, I would say personally for myself, I've always been under this understanding that a lot of Black singers go to Europe because they have a little bit more notoriety, and then they come back to the States to get these debuts. So what was it like for you at 23, supplanting there in the Netherlands, correct? So you were 20.
Correct.
What was it like adjusting and having these first successful experiences?
Well, it took a little longer than 23 I came over here at 23, but it took a bit longer than that, because first I got married and then I got divorced. And while I was married, I didn't sing.
Mm.
That's a whole nother long, long old story. We'll pass that over. But let it suffice to say that no singing part didn't quite last that long. So I started taking private lessons, and with a wonderful teacher who remained my teacher until his passing, and that was at least 20 years later. Mm-hmm. And I also was able to get into the opera studio, but by that time I was like 25, I think, at the Netherlands Opera, and that was a 3-year paid job.
Mm-hmm.
So when I got divorced, I still had 2 years to go on that contract, and I had to decide whether I would stay or come back. And I chose to stay because I had a job. And if I came back, I thought, well, I haven't been terribly successful, even though I had my master's already when I was 21. Nobody wanted to hear anything about you having a teaching job at that age, at any, you know, that was just, so what are you supposed to do? That was difficult. So I thought, well, I'll just stay, because I was getting movement lessons, and I was singing very tiny parts, you know, the third orange and the second wood nymph, the countess soprano, and those kinds of things in the big house. And then I could, you know, look and see how real opera people were delivering the goods. And it was invaluable experience. So that was one turning point. And the other turning point was after that studio, when I marched into the office of the head of the opera, and I said, okay, what are you giving me next year? And he said, nothing.
Mm.
And I said, excuse me?
Oh my God.
Nothing? And he said, no, you have to go abroad.
Mm.
And I said,
but this is abroad, you know. Sorry that, yeah, I've told this story 1,000 times, so, you know, I mean, I still think it's hilarious. But then I had to do the real hard work of doing the audition thing in Germany and Austria and Switzerland. And you'd go to these opera houses and there'd be 12 sopranos singing the same aria. That took a lot of maneuvering to get through that, because you get offered the craziest stuff. It just depended on what they needed. So I felt kind of lucky I was very lucky because I already had Columbia Artists management when I left Santa Fe as an apprentice in 72. So they helped, that helped a lot. And even though I didn't do exactly what they wanted, because, you know, I'm a little hard-headed sometimes, most of the time. And I think there are so many more opera houses, and at that time, at any rate, opportunities to actually do it here. It's like every town has at least one opera house, sometimes even two or three. So chances are you're gonna, you know, if you persevere, you're going to get your foot in the door somewhere. And that is all it takes, is the foot in the door.
Foot in the door. So especially to my young singers, near professional singers, wherever you are, your journey, the perseverance, get your foot in the door.
Be prepared.
Oh, and be prepared.
Yeah.
That came from soprano Roberta Alexander. Yes, be prepared. That's exactly right. So I want to go back to, you've had all these wonderful experiences, and now you come to the States, or I should say you get some of your big, big things here. So I was looking, reading over your bio as I was preparing, and I know I talked a lot about your Mozart roles and things of that nature. And I was reading the fact that when you did your debut at Houston Grand Opera as Pamina in Die Zauberflöte. Now, if you had to really hone in on any of these Mozart roles, I know this is probably a hard question, these Mozart roles, which is the one that really has really fed your soul as far as your voice, the way you interpret that particular character?
That's really hard, because my favorite one is Fiordaligi.
Ooh.
That's the one that speaks to me the most. I like her journey. And even though her music is killing, it's so gratifying. I loved singing her. The one that I've sung the most is Vitellia. And she is the most challenging, because actually, sort of like when you're doing her, almost your whole rehearsal period, everyone on stage is avoiding you. So if you're a sensitive type, you start to feel really depressed, because it feels like everybody doesn't like you. But she's a big challenge, because she makes a complete turnaround. And I mean, vocally she's challenging, but also as a character, because she spends the entire opera literally selling wolf tickets. And then at the end, she wants sympathy. And it's like, you know, you just saying, I'm surprised Cecil didn't just say bye, Felicia. You know, or something. But she's challenging from an acting point of view to make that believable. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so but Fyodor Ilyich would be the one that nourishes the soul the most. I mean, that music, good Lord, just heaven. Oh, yeah, hard, but heaven.
So I want to make a little bit of a transition because I know we talked about the more the traditional composers, the Mozart and so forth, but I want to go to this opera that you and I kind of talked about a little bit in the beginning, the Janacek opera. And I have a little excerpt I want to play of this. If you all would just give me just one moment with the technology. Here we go. And then I'll let you kind of review this. So I think everything should be straight. Stop right there because first of all, this opera, I'm sure the composer, the style, the storyline, I would probably say that it's definitely a stark contrast compared to something like the Mozart or the Handel or things like that. Could you maybe talk, I'll preface it then you can lead in. So I was reading up on this opera, Jenufa, I hope I said that correctly, by Janacek, and the fact that, you know, this particular opera is about basically the whole theme, the lengths and the sacrifice that you will go through, for your child or your family, or you can kind of put that kind of theme anywhere. Could you maybe talk about it where you was approached for this particular opera style?
Well, I actually, my last year in the opera studio in Amsterdam, which preceded the Glyndebourne by almost 15 years.
Oh, wow.
I sang the mayor's daughter in which is a small role that comes in the third act of in Czech. And if I'm not mistaken, Gabriela Benaschkova was the Jenufa, and she's just marvelous. So it was something where I thought, oh, I like this character. I hope one day I might be able to do this. Mm. So fast forward to 1985, when I was asked to do it at the past, and in English. Mm. So very lucky to have had the marvelous Václav Neumann as the conductor, as the maestro in that production, who literally spoon-fed me the style. And also my coach slash husband, who also was beating me over the head with the style. And I got it. I mean, I finally, it took a while, but I did get it. Those were in English. And then you need to fast forward a few years later to the Vienna State Opera. And I did them in German. So by the time I got to, it was sort of a relief to sing her in, you know, in Czech. But the character always interested me as how do you make this work? How do you make it work that in one part of the year, you're having another person's baby, the person who you love decides they don't want you, the person that you don't want to have anything to do with, but is in love with you, is so jealous that he knifes you in the face. And then by the end, when it's springtime, you decide you're going to marry the person that slashed you in the face. Mm. So it's a stretch to make that work, to make it believable but Janacek gives you the tools to get there. You know, you just have to use the tools. He gives you everything, every kind of change that you make, every growing up thing that you go through, he's given it to you. You just have to dig a little bit to find that, because it's quite difficult, because actually it's not even the real title of the opera is Her Stepdaughter. Mm. Her being the Kostelnichka. And so for some reason, I have no idea why they decided to call it Jenufa, because that's, you know, she really, she's not, it, she shouldn't be the title role, to be honest with you. It's the other soprano is the one who really, 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 really goes through the most changes. However, she wouldn't have the same impact if she didn't have the foil of the softer character of the Jenufa. So it's nice when you have a very generous colleague, so that you can play off of each other and find all these different aspects. That's probably not what you ask, but sorry.
No, you are fine. And there, I'm sure, just like myself, I was so intrigued by this opera. And as I mentioned, you know, we think about the canon, like Mozart or things like that. But when I saw this particular opera, I was like, oh my goodness. And the whole story and the nature, it was intriguing. No, you are fine. Thank you so much. It's hard to believe that our time is almost at its end. I want to point out a few more things, because we kind of lifted these things up, you know, in our conversation. So as you know, we've had a lot of things going on, both with the pandemic and, you know, with these issues of race and things like that. But the good thing is that, you know, our artists are being amplified, you know, in the midst of all of this. So that's a great thing. So I do want to talk about Porgy and Bess, because, you know, it does give a lot of opportunities, you know, in our community, especially our Black singers in opera. And I do want to talk about it because a lot of times people have these discussions, you know, is it an opera? Is it not? We both know it is an opera. It has demands of opera. But could you, I saw you do your hand. So could you maybe talk about your thoughts about Porgy and Bess and in particular the opportunities that it presented for you?
Anybody who questions whether Porgy and Bess is an opera has never saw the Madonna. That's all I've got to say. None of those people, none of those roles are non-operatic. They all have so many challenges. I mean, just think about the role of Porgy, how long it is, how all that singing. I mean, the man never shuts up. All night long, he's singing and singing and singing, and it's high. Bess is so physical and really, really, and she has three duets. It's one of those things where the music is so glorious. It's so wonderful. And it does give our people a platform. This is very true. What is wrong is not the opera, Porgy and Bess. What is wrong is that you never hear from these folks in casting departments of operas until they need a Black person.
Come on now.
Now, okay, fine. Of course, yes, I'd rather that you need a Black person, but why not, when you need that person for that role, why can't you then say, well, yes, but we can also use you for something else? I think that's all our people want. Mm-hmm. It's not Porgy and Bess per se. It's not being seen outside of that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so that has to be, that also has to be, you know, well, I don't want to say have them beat over the head with it, but it's something that actually should be beat over the head with it. Because it's just not right. So of course people are going, if that's all that the casting directors are going to do, and they also know that when they do Porgy and Bess, if I may be so bold and brazen as to say, is that it puts butts in the seats.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to sell out. I mean, they need to be sharing this further with our opera singers of color.
Mm-hmm.
And there's no reason for them not to. It's just that they just don't. And I've been there. I've certainly been there. And I was fortunate to have, to have done other things, but there was one great big old opera house who approached me for Bess. And I said, well, okay, but what else?
Mm.
And that was the end of the discussion. And I just said, well, you know, I don't really need it. So I'm sorry. I just find I find it wrong. And so I didn't do it. And I never was hired there again until recently. But that's okay. I mean, I went a different path, and so maybe it took me longer to get where I needed to be, or maybe I didn't need to be there. Mm-hmm. But all I'm saying is, these people need to be made aware that you just can't keep using people and they're reaping all the benefits. And it's not as though when people sing Porgy and Bess that they're not interested, not giving their all, or they're not, excuse me, performing to a high standard. It's just that they can do other things, and they need that. They need to have that too. Mm. And I think that's all anybody wants.
That's so true. And when you made the statement about putting butts in the seats, I experienced that because I had the opportunity to be in New York at the Met, you know, for opening night a few years back. And I'm gonna tell you, that place was packed. It was packed. And like to the main point of this, you know, yes, these are all Black trained singers. They can sing the Gershwin, but they can also sing, you know, the Mozart or the Verdi or whatever the case may be. And so I am excited that you do, you know, you have this main premiere that's gonna happen coming up, and I fire shut up in my bones, and I hope to be in New York for that. So I'm glad that we're having some of these opportunities. But yes, I do want to put this spotlight, you know, as we wrap up our time together, and I know it's there in Amsterdam. I'm sure that you're relaxing and you want to continue to relax there. It's approaching noon here. But I do want to play just an excerpt of you singing in Porgy and Bess, just for the listeners, just to treat the listeners. And I'm going to bring up a popular recording here. And thank you all for bearing with me in this technology. Let's see here. Oh, for some reason, my screen seems to be jumping. I hope that's not being translated on the, let me stop this for a second. Uh-oh. Hope you all are not hearing it. I think you may be, but just 1 second. Sorry about that. And let me see, can we go here? But meanwhile, while you all are waiting for me to get the technology together, I want to thank everyone for listening to this installment of the Opera Diva series. It's a joy to have soprano Roberta Alexander with us today on this series. And let's try this one more time. Here we go. I think this might work. I almost need to hire a technician to help me with this stuff. Let's see. Oh, I think I had it right the first time. Okay, let's try this. Here we go. I don't know if I can cheat the people on this one.
You miss, and you must laugh and sing and dance.
So as you mentioned, I mean, all of that is operatic control. You know, it's nothing, nothing like playtime about that. You either you can sing the stuff or you can't.
You can't, yeah.
Well, Miss Roberta, thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you for having
me. It's just been such a joy. And as I mentioned earlier, long overdue, for some reason, I'm having a little, wait a minute, I'm trying to get us back together on the screen. Let me see here. There we go. I just want to thank you so much just for being here and sharing about your career. And, you know, I want to, this is kind of like way down the thing. We were talking about earlier about these virtual presentations, and you were talking about somehow we were talking about something, but the favorite, another favorite one I enjoyed was when you had the conversation with Lawrence Brownlee. And you all were talking about tennis.
Yes. We're both tennis fanatics, even though we like different players.
Well, thank you so much. And as we bring our conversation to a close, again, I can't say enough. It has been a joy talking with you. And just final thoughts, do you have anything, just a final thought that maybe you want to communicate to the audience, or maybe like a young opera singer who is on this path? I know you mentioned preparation earlier, but if you had to add to that bouquet, what would you add?
Times 100, preparation times 100. You can never be prepared enough.
Wow.
I mean, really, I'm honest. That's one of the things that's I find is really, you think, yeah, that's the most important thing, is just that kind of thing. So that when you're in a situation, you don't even have to think. You just know what to do. And because, you know, there's all kinds of things that happen. Even though we try not to let people get in our heads, or an unkind word or an unkind gesture, you have to have that thing inside that you know that you are running on optimal capacity of what you can do, so that there's nothing else that anyone else can ask of you. And so then they can't, because you know inside that you're doing what you need to be doing. So no matter what anybody tries to do or say or anything, you know. And that only comes when you have, not, I'm not saying that you don't have any doubts, because that's not, but you don't have any doubts about your preparedness. Maybe you have a doubt about, well, I could have done that better. Yes, of course you could have done that better. We all want to do it better, but it's not because you didn't prepare.
That is...
Sorry.
No. That was wise, and the people need to hear.
I'm on that soapbox.
No. I need to hear that, because no matter what, whether you're talking about, you know, music or any other profession, the key is definitely preparation. So you brought that home. Thank you so much. Again, we've been listening to the legendary, the incomparable soprano Roberta Alexander on this installment of the Opera Diva series. So thank you so much for being here. And listeners, please make sure that you subscribe on YouTube to Across the Arts. This is where you can find all of these upcoming interviews and these wonderful series as this one. I want to bring your attention to next week. We mark the birthday of soprano Kathleen Battle, August 13th, on the show, a big tribute show with fans sending in videos and so forth. So I hope that you all will put that on your calendar. And then following someone that you may know very well, Miss Roberta, I will interview the incomparable Vincent Cole. So make sure you include all these dates on your calendar. I'll try to remind you all. But again, we have been joined by the legendary soprano, Roberta Alexander. Thank you so much for being here and giving me this opportunity. It means the world to me. Again, I am your host, Patrick D. McCoy. You've been listening and watching Across the Arts, wherever you are in the world. So, you know, it's too early for me to have a cocktail, but again, thank y'all. Just toast to you, Miss Alexander. Thank you so much for being here. Again, this has been Across the Arts, and I hope that you